Praise the Lord, Church.
Amen.
Waithera Onyango is my name, and I'll be reading the word for today from the book of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse 1 to 21. Ephesians, chapter 5, from verse 1 to 21. On our church Bible, it's on page 919. I believe we're all there, are we? Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1 to 21, and I'll read. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not even be named among you, as is proper among saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place, but instead let there be thanksgiving. For you may be sure of this, that everyone who is sexually immoral or impure, or who is covetous, that is, an idolater, has no inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not become partners with them. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. And that's the word of the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
My name is Geoffrey Wachira, and I am married to Mary Njeri, who is seated at the back there. And together we have two children, Kim, who has gone to Sunday school, and Eve. And we are thankful to God for the opportunity to come and share God's word with you this morning. And I thank God for opening of the word. So far we have seen that the book of Ephesians is divided into two parts, and it's been a great opportunity for us to keep learning under the man of God, and we continue learning today. So I'm going to look at this big chunk here, which is very much packed, as we will see. And I am supposed to preach all these in one sermon, something I think would even take like three. So it seems like the elders have learned from the Ministry of Education. I am a teacher, where we have now condensed the terms. We have four terms in 1 year, and we are supposed to cover the same content, you know. So I think my work has already equipped me to do what I'm going to do today, squeeze a lot of content in a very short time. So let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you this morning that you have given us an opportunity to hear your word. Thank you for the gift of the Bible, and that we can now hear your word, know your will, and know how to live wisely in this world, so that we may be those who are like Christ. We pray that, Lord, you're going to open our hearts as we have sung this morning, that you may break the hardness, you may soften the ground, so that your word will take root and grow. We thank you, and this we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. So the title here, which I have given this message, is Imitators of God. And I know that the poster reads Imitators of Christ, but as we will come to see, imitating God includes, or rather it means imitating Christ, because he is our supreme example. So we are called to imitate God in our Christian walk, since we are God's children, as we have been told by the Bible, that God is our Father, and we're not just children. If you read the opening verse there, we are beloved children, as we have seen. And this came at a great cost. Let me take us back to how we became beloved children of God, or how we come to know about that. God displayed his love to us through Jesus Christ, who gave himself up, as we have read, as a fragrant offering and sacrifice. It is Christ who, even if he is God, he came here on earth, was born like a man, like any one of us, and then he lived a holy life, which we could not live. Remember that the demands of God's word is that we should live perfect lives. We couldn't, all the way from the Garden of Eden. But Christ came and lived that holy life that we were expected to live. And then he died our death, because the wages of sin is death, and we, our human beings, have been sinful since the fall, since the Garden of Eden. But God has been gracious to us to come through Christ Jesus and save us and pay the wages of sin, which is death, on our behalf. Our sins had to be atoned for. They had to be paid for in full. And none of us could really make that payment, but Jesus did that. Remember how what we have covered so far. We have been reminded again and again that we were dead in sin. That is for believers. And for non-believers, they are still in death, the death of sin and transgression, as we saw in chapter 2. We are being reminded that God is so gracious. This is the foundation. Sometimes when you look at from chapter 4 all the way to chapter 6, we might think of Christianity, if you're not careful, we might think of Christianity as a list of do's and don'ts, but that is not the point. That's why we have to mention the foundation. Where are we? Why are we to live the way we are supposed to live? It is because of the foundation, or our identity, as we have seen so far, the identity that we have in Christ. And that's why we have to stress again and again that we are children of God. And therefore, because we are children of God, then how should we respond? How should we live our lives? The gift of faith in Christ Jesus has been graciously given to us so that we may be able to, so that we may receive the forgiveness from God, and reconciliation. We have seen that word, that now we are one with God. That is, the vertical relationship has been mended. We are one with God, and we are one with one another. We saw how there is unity in chapter 4, as Pastor Kamau preached to us, and also chapter 2, seeing how Jews and the Gentiles are now one in Christ. That is horizontal relationship. So see, it forms a shape of a cross. Relationship with God, when it is mended, we are reconciled to God, then we are reconciled one with another. And that's why, as a church here, we call each other brothers and sisters. And that unity, it is because of what God has done. So we have said that God is our Father, and we are his children, and therefore, we ought to imitate him. Now, we have a son, Kim, who imitates what my wife and I do. When he sees us cooking, you'll now see he already has a fake cooker, and you'll hear him saying, napika chai, uji, napika njahe, ugali, just nyama, mayai, cabbage, and soup. Now, that soup, my wife, you know why he says that. Yeah? Soup. Now, children learn by imitation. And Kim is learning to imitate everything. If for example, he doesn't want to take water, and I take a cup of water and sit down and drink, guess what he will do? Even if he has said no to water, he will drink it, because he wants to do what I am doing. And that's why our identity as children of God is very crucial in our understanding why then we ought to imitate our God, because we are his children. Children learn by imitation. So what we will see today is how then we should respond to God's kindness in adopting us as children, and then we know how then we should respond. Those who are married, you know that if you do acts of kindness to your spouse, it's likely that it will be reciprocated. And they will also be, you know, respond probably in giving you a great service, and there will be happiness in the home. We know that. So great acts of love are reciprocated. Well, unless your spouse is donkey-like and not Christ-like. You know, Asante Yapunda Dinini. But good thing is that we are children of God, so we are God-like or Christ-like, which is a good thing. Now, this message today, we are going to divide it into three main sections. So it's one point, if you look at it keenly, but it has three dimensions. So I'm going to ask this question, and we are going to spend the rest of the time answering this question. How do we imitate God? So if the topic is imitators of Christ or imitators of God, then how should we imitate God? We imitate God by walking in love, walking in the light, and walking in wisdom. Those are the three main points. Let's see whether you are good students. I'll read the question and read the answer. Let's see how your retention power. How should we imitate God?
Walking in wisdom.
Excellent. I wish you were my students. My means course should be an A. Okay, in my workplace, that is. You know, I have a teacher. So if I had students like you, I would be the teacher of the year. Anyway, let's go to point number one, walking in love, which we are going to see from verse 1 to verse 5. So I'm not going to read again, but I will ask you to keep your Bible open, and as we go, you check, as like the Bereans, check whether what I'm saying is true, whether it's what is in the text. So I want us to focus on the text. So in this passage we have read, we have heard the word walk being repeated three times. If you're using ESV, most of us are. It is used figuratively. The word walk is used figuratively to mean moral conduct in terms of thoughts, words, and deeds or action. Love is described here, as described here, is not just a feeling. You know, this we are in a culture where feelings are exaggerated. But love here is more of action that has been done. And we have seen that God is love. But think of this. If God claimed to love us, and he did not do anything to save us, think about that. He did nothing to save us, and he left us to go to hell, where we deserve. It's true, we deserve it. But would we understand his love? Would you know his love if he just allowed us to, you know, to go to hell? No, we wouldn't. But he did something. He did something for us to understand and to know what love is. And that is through the supreme example of Jesus Christ. So today, as we talk of imitating God, we are going to see what Christ has done and therefore how we should respond to that. So we praise God that we now know God's love because of what he has done to us or for us through Jesus Christ. Now we are dearly loved children and we are called to love God and men. But how are we going to love God? In the first portion, chapter 1, verse 1 to 5, these are some of the things that have been given here. I'm not going to deeply look into this list one by one, but I've categorized it into two main chunks. Which one? We are talking of how do we love God and man? Number one, abstaining. So probably you might want to think, how do we walk in love? It is by abstaining from all forms of sexual immorality. This would include things like pornography, masturbation, flirting, adultery, fornication, homosexuality, and such kind of sins. Moral impurity, greed, wanting what other people have, which the Bible in this portion has described it as idolatry. That is, you are placing things or you are attaching higher value to things other than God. But the Bible is telling us that not even a hint of these things should be heard among Christians. Not even a hint. So The way we live in public and in private reflects the validity of our faith. Now, we cannot claim to be believers and we are living like non-believers. We ought to live in love. The other thing we have been told how to walk in love is by abstaining from verbal sin or sins, filthiness, foolish talk, vulgar joking, such as saying things with double meaning, mostly with sexual innuendos or connotations. You hear someone use words, the words in themselves are, there's nothing wrong with the words, but they have a hidden meaning. And sometimes you hear people say something and people laugh and you wonder, where is the joke? It's because they have meaning behind those words. So you just think it is innocent, but it is not. So we are, as believers, are not supposed to be using that. Of course, jokes may make people laugh, and you know, and but we ought to be very careful even how we use jokes, because we could be hurting someone else. Just imagine this: you come and we invite you, and we cook for you in Jahe, and then you come and you make a comment, and you say, "Ah, umetupikia ile chakula ya hardware." Now that one is a joke. You might think of it as a joke, but the person who has prepared, how do they feel? You see, so you see how jokes can be hurting. Even if, it's light, you meant it to be a light one, but it can be hurting. We have all been tempted with in all these sins that we have mentioned, and probably you have fallen to them at one point or another. Maybe when you're dead in sin, you used to live in those things, or even after being saved, because of the residual sin, the sin that is still in, you may have continued to do that. Now, you may tell me that the first category of sexual sin, that one, you cannot fall for that. Well, I want to tell you that you have to be careful, as we will see later on. But then the second set is where mostly you'll find Christians falling in. Do you complain over many things like perceived unfairness? You know, like me, I remember the day we had gone somewhere to a contest. We have taken students to a science contest, and after the exam, we were asked to mark, and then after marking, we gave the results, and then there is always a token of appreciation, and we were given 500, and we were expecting 2,000. Now, no one had said that it is 2,000, but in our minds, it seems like we had agreed, even without talking, that it should be at least 2,000 and above. And then we were complaining there, and there was a lady there who was not complaining, and she said, "Guys, no one even had promised us the 500. Why can't you take it and be thankful?" And at that point, I could not bring my mind to thinking that I should be thankful. You know, I felt like, this is unfair. We've worked the whole day. Are you engrossed with criticism? You know, you cannot let something go. For example, those who are married, you know this. You know, you are served food. Someone has taken time to prepare the food, and they bring it to you, well prepared, well presented. And then the first thing you comment, "Hii chakula iko na chumvi nyingi sana." And the person has taken time to prepare. You have not even appreciated the food first. All that you see is what is wrong. And remember that this is how we are naturally. If we are not keen, we are tuned to see what is wrong rather than what is good. So we tend to complain because we are not thankful, as we will see shortly. But the call today is for us to be different. We cannot live like everyone else. And the stakes are high, because obedience and walking in love would make us children of God, of course. And then, or because we are children of God, we obey. And then we get to the kingdom of God, or we are heirs of the kingdom of God with all its blessings. Remember how James taught us in chapter 1, the blessings. We get that. And then the sad thing is, for those who do not walk in love, what have we been told here? We have been told that they will not inherit the kingdom of God. If you are to use the terms people are using nowadays, we'll say that they will see the kingdom of God on Viusasa. But unfortunately, even Viusasa will not survive thereafter. So you will not even see it. You will not inherit. And that is a sad thing. So we ought to be very careful how we are thinking. Now, take note that when we say of these sins and not inheriting the kingdom of God, we don't mean those people when you fall as a Christian and you're repentant and you're restored. That is not the person I'm referring to. Those who will not see the kingdom of God are those who are enjoying the sin. They are living in sinful ways, and their lifestyle is just a lifestyle of sinning. Now, those are the ones who will not inherit the kingdom of God. So how do we take care of these two chunks or list of sins? And how do we walk in love in that regard? It is by being thankful. We have been told to be thankful. Now, sometimes you may wonder, how will thankful help me not to be sexually immoral or to be vulgar in my talk? But just think of this. When you think of God's love and what he did for us, what he did for you, you respond with thanksgiving to him. And you see him as the supreme being, as the one whose your loyalty should be. And if he says, do not do this, you will be willing to obey because of what he has already done for you. And that's why thanksgiving is given here as a way of us turning away from all these sins. If I am thankful, even if the food has a lot of salt, I'll not complain. I'll first be thankful. And sometimes you find that as you are thankful, you realize that even that food was not as salty, you know, so that you don't tend to complain. You tend to be thankful, and that one helps you. Now, let me ask you, or you could be thinking of this thing. Do you reflect loving God by honoring and obeying his word, by not using your body for self-pleasure or your tongue for unwholesome talk? Do you love your neighbors by not uncovering their nakedness physically, that first type of sins, sexual sins, or verbally, the second kind of verbal sins? Do you get envious because of the blessings of others? We have looked at this and we may think that we are immune, but I remember my wife telling me that she does get envious when she, just like any one of us, there are some things you would see and you're envious, or maybe it is in your workplace and you realize that a colleague who you thought you were on the same level, you realize they are paid more than you. And you're like, this is unfair, you know. It should be me, and probably you work even more than them. You know, your track record could be better. So do you feel envious of them? These are things that we face as believers here on earth. But we are told this. We should find reason, or rather how we apply this is by finding reason to be thankful. Be thankful for that salary you're getting. Don't be bitter because of someone else who is earning more. Being thankful even when people around you are not reciprocating the love you're showing them. The call for us is to walk in love. Next point is walking in the light. Verse 6 all the way to 14. 6 to 14. Walking in the light means doing away with sins and following Christ. As simple as that. Stopping sinning, following Christ. We do this by guarding ourselves from deception of false teachers and false teachings. Have you heard of the lordship debate? Anyone? I asked my wife and she told me that she has. If you have not heard, don't worry. It's a group of Christians or people who claim to be Christians who say that you can be saved by Christ, but Christ is not your Lord. Okay? You can be saved by Jesus Christ, but you have not submitted your life to Christ. So you have the freedom to do whatever you want as long as you are saved at a point, or maybe you say the prayer at a point. Remember those prayers we used to say, Rudia nyuma yangu. Now, there are some people who believe after saying that, it doesn't matter how they live. And we are warned here. That's why we are told, do not be deceived. Let me ask, you know, sometimes I wonder, what is wrong with people? How do they reason? Is it possible to live contrary to the word of Christ and then claim to be saved by the same Christ? Is it making sense? My wife would say, you cannot eat your cake and have it. You have heard of liberal Christians, maybe. people who say that the church should be tolerant. For example, we should allow same-sex marriages. We should even officiate those marriages. And we have heard of churches which are okay doing that. They are allowing things, and if you tend to not agree with them, they tell you, okay, then if you don't want to participate in that, then keep quiet, live and let live. You probably have heard that statement. But biblical Christians, we must reject, refute, and expose these deceptions. But how are we going to do this? We'll come to the next point on how to do that. But the warning today is that do not be deceived. There are many teachings going around. And believers, if you're not keen, if you're not grounded in the word, as we are trying as a church to make sure that we are grounded, we will be deceived. So let me give you some warnings. Do not be deceived that once saved, always saved, no matter how you live, how sinful and unrepentant you live. This teaching is a lie. Do not be deceived that masturbation is good for your health. It is not. Don't be deceived that sex outside marriage is okay as long as it is safe and you're not caught. It is not. It is detestable before God. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived that same-sex marriage are okay, since the victims are helpless in the attraction. That's the reason they give. You don't choose who you are attracted to. But these relations aren't even marriage. They cannot be defined biblically as marriage. It is against God's will. We will face these things as believers. People around us, we will hear them holding to this kind of truth. Some of them even claiming to be Christians. But don't be deceived that flirting with men and women, married or single, that it is okay as long as you don't cross the line and get to have sex with them. It is not. Don't be deceived that gossip, even in the name of sharing prayer requests or silently listening to such sweet gossip, is right. It is not. This is uncovering your neighbor's nakedness. Don't be deceived that sexually charging jokes, which will keep the conversation alive or just to make people laugh, is okay. Some of those are defiling and embittering. We have to be very cautious. Do not be deceived that you are strong against temptations. You're not. And that means that you need to take great caution. Do not be deceived that watching those obscene movies and you know, in your gadgets, in your phone, you know, those buttons that pop up, click if you want to see. Very enticing. We have to be very careful. Don't think that it is not that bad, because that is inappropriate. Don't be deceived that being envious of what your brother or sister has is not that bad, because sometimes we soften sin. It is not okay. And don't be deceived that being honest with your feelings supersedes thanksgiving, that you need to say how angry you are of the salt rather than being thankful to God. Now this one, we remember that we are called to be humble, gentle, patient, bearing with one another in love, as we were taught from chapter 4 verse 1 by Pastor Kamau. Remember that. Do not be deceived that it is your money, your dress, your body, your choice. It is not. Because it belongs to God and you have to be a good steward. So don't be deceived. Don't be deceived that you should mind your business. Even when your brother or a sister is drifting away from the faith, or a friend is living in sin and, you know, let's coexist, and so you don't tell them, you don't point them to Christ lovingly. Keeping quiet when people are getting into sin doesn't make you holy. Actually, the Bible is calling us to refute. You need to talk. If it is a brother, you need to gently correct them, point them to Christ. So we are called not only to abstain this manner of sins, but also not to associate with those people who do them, but even to expose them, point them to Christ, who is the light. Now, the story I've just given you of that time when we were complaining, that lady who did not complain and was thankful about the 500 when we are complaining, you know what? By contrast, she was exposing our hearts. So sometimes exposing sin does not even need you to say anything, but it needs you to stand with the truth and do what is right. And then there will be contrast. We are complaining. She is contented. That is, by contrast, we were exposed as greedy. That's what I was at that time. So the good thing is that we know that the work of Christ, the light will work in one way or another. And we know how light works. For example, if I give you a note and you want to confirm whether it is genuine or fake, how do you do that? You see people holding the note against the light. So they want to see the light. Or even those people who use UV light, you point on it, on the note, and then if it is fake, you will know. If it is genuine, you will see the markings, the genuine markings in the note, and you will know whether it is fake or not. The light exposes sinfulness. But we Christians are not to walk in darkness, because we have been changed. We are children of the light. Therefore, you Christian who is entertaining sin or sinful people in your life, however petty this sin may appear, you need to wake up from your sin and let the light of Christ shine on you as the word of God is being preached. Don't be like a pig which you clean it, it goes back to the mud. No, we can't do that as believers, and we shouldn't, as we are reminded today by God's word. Instead, we should bear fruit of righteousness, of the light, which we are told is goodness, righteousness, and truth. When the word of God is living in us, we will keep on growing in these godly virtues. And this is not an event, but it is a way of life. It's a lifestyle. We need to keep growing. So if you are a non-Christian and you're living in sin and you're here today and you have not put your faith in Christ Jesus, I beseech you that by the work of the Holy Spirit in your heart, through the word of God as it is being preached this moment, that you will be raised from the dead, you will rise from the dead, and let the light of Christ shine on you, that you may know him. Thirdly, walk in wisdom, which we find from verse 15 all the way to 21. Now, wisdom can easily be defined as skillful living. That is, applying God's word in our daily living. And you can say that it involves building a worldview, or rather a biblical worldview, which we can use to interpret situations. And after interpreting them correctly or biblically, we respond to those situations. Now, we know that Christ is the embodiment of wisdom, as we see that in 1 Corinthians 1:25. So when we are told to walk in wisdom, essentially we are being told to live like Christ. We are called to walk carefully, looking in us and around us to see whether we are putting to practice, we are applying God's truth as we hear them, as we are taught, and in the way we live, even as we guard our hearts from deception. Wisdom calls us to apply God's truth and be careful how we are living every day. To do this, we need to understand God's word. What we see in this last point here, or that portion there, 15 to 21, is that God's word gives us general principles. That's why it's telling us, know the will of God, understand, discern the will of God. So those general principles are the ones which, by God's grace, we are given the wisdom and discernment to be able to apply. So you have the truth, and if you're not careful, you'll just know the truth and it will not affect the way you live. I remember yesterday we were somewhere and there was one lady after we were taught, and she was saying that the problem is not knowing the truth, that we should be contented. We know the Bible, we know those verses. The problem is putting it into practice, and that's the truth, children of God, this morning. And that's why we need God's wisdom, a Christian, a biblical worldview, so that it may help us to put to practice how the word of God in how we live daily. By wisdom, we know exactly what and how to put off our old self and to put on our new self in Christ. So quickly, three things that we need to do as we walk in wisdom is to make the best use of time, because days are evil. So how do you spend your time? Is it in meaningful way, keeping you alert to what God is doing in and around you, Or is it numbing you? The way you spend your time, is it making you insensitive to what God is doing around you? How do you spend your time? Is it honoring God? Is it adding spiritual value to you and to those who are around you? Now, take note that our old nature is attracted to evil and would want you to waste as much time as possible so that you don't do the work that God wants you to, or live the way God wants you to live in terms of your thoughts, your desires, your words, your action. Our nature will be to corrupt us, to make us less like Christ. But we are called to be more like Christ, and that's why we have to be wise and fight sin in our lives. So instead of complaining, for example, as we have seen, instead of criticism, instead of hurting or defiling jokes, we should be people filled with thanksgiving. Instead of being drunk with wine, we ought to be people who are filled with the Holy Spirit. And because we say that we are in a culture where we want to feel good, we ought to be very careful what we mean by being filled with the Holy Spirit. So I will simply say that this is not about, you know, those sentimental feelings and thinking, but it's more about, it's about being having Christ dwell in your hearts. That is the word of Christ dwelling in your heart more and more. As you keep learning the word of, and allowing Christ to rule in your heart, the Holy Spirit to work in your heart, that is what being filled with the Holy Spirit is. It is really submitting yourself to the work of the Holy Spirit in making you more like Christ in your hearts. That's what filling with the Holy Spirit means, so that you don't go there and saying, because you don't speak in tongues, you're not filled. That's not what filling means. So we express the filling of the with the Holy Spirit, as we see here, by cordial fellowship. We see people who are singing together, as we were singing there, or rather as we were reading the catechism answers, we heard of public and private worship. So here there is a sense in which praising God in singing is both public, like we are doing together, and also private when we are at home or even at our mission or community groups. We joyfully sing to the Lord. We are encouraging one another through the singing, because as we sing, we are really preaching God's word to each other. And that's why I believe the elders are so keen on the songs that they, or rather the songs that are sung in church, so that those songs will be really preaching the gospel. They will be speaking the gospel and not whatever we want to hear. So as we sing, we are helping one another know that the word of God. And as we continue singing, we are also singing with thanksgiving. We are thanking God. We are praying to God. That's what the Holy Spirit is doing in us. It's drawing our hearts more and more to God, so that we may have our faith, hope, and trust in Jesus Christ, who is representing us to the Father. So another way which will be more looked at in the next passage, which I will not do much to talk about, is mutual submission. So the one who is looking at the next portion will help us. But for us to submit to the authority around us, then it calls for humility, it calls for gentleness, it calls for patience, bearing with one another in love as we maintain the bond of peace, the unity, which, if you remember, Pastor Kamau taught us the other day. So we have considered the Christian walk, or imitating God. And these are the things that we have looked at. We have first looked at walking in love. Second, we have looked at walking in the light. And thirdly, we have looked at walking in wisdom. So I'm now concluding. You can start celebrating. Look at the three walks. And the three walks are related. A couple of wrap up here. Walking in love is about putting off our sinful habits and putting on godly habits. We have looked at that even in last Sunday, as Reverend Harrison was helping us in that passage. So walking in light is being watchful to ensure that we are walking in love daily, detecting what is sinful or those deceptions, and not only detecting them, but refuting them and exposing them. Walking in wisdom is being prompt, as we have seen, to correctly apply God's word to daily life as we walk in love and in light. Now notice that light, love, and wisdom have been in various parts of the Bible being used to refer to God and Christ. So essentially, our call today is God calling us to himself, so that through Christ, and as the work of Christ is being may are effected in our hearts, that we may apply God's word in our hearts and live godly lives. So our call is to be more like Christ, if you may summarize that, in every day of our lives, as we continue putting off sinfulness and putting on godliness. So we are to be Christ-shaped and not culture-shaped. So we have to be very keen of that. So the passage has many direct imperatives or direct commands and instructions for us to apply. So even if I don't tell you how to apply these, I believe that a lot of what we have said, they are very direct and you know how you should live. But it's always good to stress on a few points. So let me stress on a couple of points here on how we can apply what we have learned today in our lives. So the first thing, how are you not walking in light, love, and wisdom? How are you not walking in love, light, and wisdom? Think about that, because you know yourself. I want you to use a moment of reflecting. What sins are setting you back? Now, I would want to ask you this, that as we take tea today, after the service, ask someone, preferably from your mission or community, of the same gender, will be more helpful, and ask them which area of struggle, as we have considered above, which areas are they struggling with? And then don't just ask and end there. Also ask, how is God's word speaking to them concerning that particular area of struggle? And then from there, encourage them, follow up on them, and to see how they are making progress. How are they moving on in the journey of putting off and then putting on? Be accountable to one another, and I would say that do this with confidentiality. As we have seen concerning the verbal sin, don't let no one share with you their struggle and then they hear that struggle being mentioned somewhere. So confidentiality will be so helpful in this as you walk together in our missional community as believers, brothers and sisters. Second thing, when deception comes, and it will surely come, how will you respond? Are you ready with the word of God? Are you ready with the fruit of light, that is the truth, to detect, to refute, and to expose deception with love? Remember, again, walking in love. So even when you're saying that this is sinful, it should be in love. If someone who says that if love is not accompanied by the truth, that one would be sentimentality. It would just be a feeling. But again, if the truth is not accompanied by love, it will be harsh. And it might put people off or away from the gospel rather than close to the gospel. So even as you are approaching people, you see, maybe they could be friends, they could be believers, brothers and sisters, and you think they're going wrong here. So be wise on how you approach them, how you talk to them. This means you must have the word of Christ richly dwelling in your heart so that you may be able to apply it in such occasions as it is demanded. For example, an example is you're watching television with your spouse, children or friends, a brother or a sister. And then it features, a program features same-sex marriages or a couple there. And the program is trying to show us how normal that one is, and it's okay. So how do you seize that opportunity to remind ourselves and to guard ourselves from such deception? One of the ways you can do that is to let the children know, or the people you are watching with, that homosexuality is living in sinfulness. It is a sin. Don't just let that moment pass. You need to pause there and say, you see that, especially with children who like to copy everything that they hear or they see on TV. Tell them, let them know. Because sometimes you may not guard them. You may try to guard them and give them Christian content. But remember, they will face these things. Probably you're watching a program said to be family program. And then you see something that you are very sure this is against God's word. Pause there and tell the children that is sinfulness. We shouldn't do that. As believers. Next, when you are at home, or whether you are at home, the missional community, the church, workplace, market, and so forth, make it a habit to thank God for the people in your life, and especially when they do little gestures of service. It may not be a big thing, but someone has helped you with a child, or someone has seen you struggling in a particular way and they have come to the rescue. It may not be a big thing, but make it a habit to be thankful. When you're given change after buying food, or you've been served in a shop, say, be thankful. That one will guard your heart from complaining. This person is taking too long to serve me. You know, you may feel like that when you're going to a shop. But if you're thankful, you're guarded from that. You're seeing that these people are doing what they can do to try and save you. So serve you. So be thankful. Don't complain. When someone is serving you, let's say the example we are using of food, and you realize that something is off with this food, what is your first response? So I ask you that it should be first thanksgiving. Don't be quick to complain. Don't be quick to say what was wrong. And I remember our pastor, our elders here telling us that you will see a lot of things going wrong in the church plant. Please be kind to the people who are trying to serve you. They may not serve you perfectly, but they are serving you all together. Be thankful. Thank God for them. Encourage them. Don't kill them. Don't put them down by your comments, because you want things to be perfect. So let's bear with one another. Finally, before you share a prayer point, this is another point we looked at, especially on sensitive matter. I've shared with you some of ways in which I'm struggling. Maybe I come and share to you, I'm struggling financially. Don't go sharing that with other people. The best thing would be to ask me if you would be okay to share that with a praying group, for example. I may tell you, yes, it is okay. And maybe as you share it, someone might hear that this is a need I can meet and you will come to my help. That's one way. But if I say I don't want you to share it, I just want it to remain between the two of us, as a believer, please don't gossip. Keep it between the two of you. The first point I've asked to share your area of struggle. And that's why the last point must be confidentiality. Don't share what someone is vulnerable with you. Maintain that secret. Don't sin verbally. Don't expose them, as we have seen in the text. Let me pause there, even as we wait for the person who will come here next week and continue with the opening of God's word. So remember those 4 points we have mentioned of application. And from here, let's see how we are going to put that in practice, even as we grow to be more like Christ as we imitate him. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that today you have taught us on how to be imitators of God by imitating your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray that you're going to help us to walk in love, walk in the light, walk in wisdom, to be more like you, to be more like your Son, Jesus Christ. And concerning how we put these truths to practice, for most time we realize that it is not knowing the truth that is the problem, but are we believing in these truths? And are we ready to put them to practice? And as we have seen that you're giving us wisdom, I pray that wisdom, that discernment, you'll grant it to every one of these believers, that they may know how to put to practice the truths that we have been learning today, in ways that we share here, and even in ways that you will continue revealing to them, helping them to know, even in circumstances that we have not mentioned there, but let your word be effective and applied in our day-to-day life, and especially when we are at our workplaces, at our homes, in the marketplace, wherever we are, that we will live as children of light, that we will live as those who are imitating Christ, that are imitating God. So help us, Lord, for this we pray in your Son's name. Amen.